the ship. So initially, question one will first be responded to by Morgan and Payal. The second question will first be responded to by
Vincent. I'm currently a third year studying a Bachelor of Arts majoring in philosophy with a minor in writing. My three major policies are that I would like to buy or lease a student bar. I'd like to work with the DCC to implement a housing warrant of fitness citywide. And I would also like to work with other students' associations around the country to lobby the government on important student issues.
Hello, I'm Laura Harris. My three good policies, the first of all, are national to be removed for postgraduate students, and particularly medical students are affected by that. And the third is a more visible executive, so that's executive that are on the ground, talking to you guys, interacting with you, finding out what you need in order to put your ideas up to the big guys.
Hey everyone, my name's Paul. I'm a law and politics student. My three biggest policies are, firstly, is empowering clubs and societies. There is a great and diverse range of activities and initiatives which happen on campus, and we need to do our best to empower people initiatives and take action. My second policy is looking at increasing or starting part of OUSA's investment portfolio, looking at startups and empowering students who want to be entrepreneurial and have businesses which affect social change. And my third policy is professionalising and beefing up student representation. We've already got wins getting access to the Vice-Chancellor's advisory group, but we need to do more at a national level to make sure that we're able to persuade all political parties to make changes.
Hi, I'm Payal and I'm running for president. Also, my three big policies are working with the DCC to make sure students are included in the planning stages of all their work. So that's submitting on plans and strategies that they put out when they're open for consultation, and also doing things like submitting on the long-term plans, things like that. Yeah. For example, on the skateboarding bylaw. My second policy is making a tertiary union model that actually works and represents all students together. I think that OUSA made the right decision withdrawing from NZUSA, but it's our responsibility to make a model that actually works for all of us. My last policy goal thing is making the neighbourhood project successful, getting it up and running. So pretty much what that's about is making flatting better for everyone. That's not just insulation or anything like that. That's insulations are structurally in the house itself, reducing energy consumption, reducing waste, helping with mental health and things like that.
So the first question I'll be asking all the candidates is a general question, starting first with Nina. So what do you think is the biggest issue facing tertiary students in New Zealand, and how do you propose to fix this issue? Now, I do also posit a caveat that as prior executive members, to please state specific actions that you could realistically do in your role as president.
I would say that one of the biggest issues facing students in New Zealand is a lack of funds. So obviously the student allowances, student loans aren't enough to cover what our expenses realistically are nationwide, not so much in Dunedin, but more around the country. I think that the best way to work on that, I mean, there's nothing that, there's not much that students' associations themselves can do. It's something which associations will have to work together to lobby the government on these important issues, make sure that student voices are heard by the government, and basically just be a pain in their ass until they actually realise that we're not going to go away. So that's how I would work to do that. I would look at setting up a sort of a coalition of students' associations who would work together to lobby the government on issues such as student loans and allowances to try and get them raised or tied to the rate of inflation or something.
Hi, I think one of the biggest issues is representation of students in the national sphere. And so that means what I would do in order to rectify that would be running campaigns, running protests, being able to centralise those sort of movements that should be coming from the student voice, because the government aren't going to change unless they hear that we want changes to be made and they hear that on a grand scale. And that's what I believe me and my team would be able to facilitate. And we're already out just for this campaign period, being seen, being noticed, talking to you guys. And I believe that that is a big part of student representation, is rallying the students together so that we are listened to. And it has happened in the past, and I do believe it can happen again.
I think the biggest issue facing students is living costs, which links into another big issue of mental health. The numbers of people reporting Firstly, is to advocate for the student allowance to be tied to the rate of inflation. Many government payments are tied to the rate of inflation, but the living allowance is not, so it should be. The second thing we can do on campus is use the student groups which exist at the moment, who run many welfare and academic support programs, and continue to invest in those to ensure there are visible mechanisms of help and ways that people can work with each other in order to have a good time at university.
So I think the biggest issues facing students are the conditions that we live in, so conditions of flats, and the way that student loans and student allowances currently work. Realistic actions that I've done so far, last year I ran, this year what I've done is submitted on the Glen City Council's long-term plan to make sure students are being represented and thought about at a planning stage. And what I continue to do is make sure we get a tertiary model of representation that represents all students, so we can get traction together to work together to improve things for students. And with the conditions of flats here, I'll be running my neighbourhood project.
So the next question are specific questions relating to each of the candidates and the policies that outlined their blurb. So starting with Laura Harris. You stated in your candidate blurb that you would like to increase the quality of services provided to students. And so my question to you is, what are some issues which you can identify with the current quality of services which are provided to students, and how do you plan on fixing them? And I do ask that you provide concrete examples.
It's a very good question. Services to students. The thing with OUSA is that I believe it serves for two different purposes. Half of that purpose is representation of students on a national level, the other half of that is services. And so the kind of services OUSA runs are things like the O Week events, and I believe a lot of the people here have already spoken about mental health issues and increasing on the sort of welfare issues and unifying those clubs that deal with those issues and making sure that those are a priority and that the mental health issue is definitely dealt with. So I think that's a service that we can improve, the student support service. Not that it doesn't already do exceptionally well, but there are always improvements that can be made. Other services that we'd like to see provided for students are things like free flu shots, so that you have an opportunity to avoid the threat of flu, things like free graduation photos. These are all services that could be provided by OUSA that currently aren't being.
So Paul, your question is relating to you mentioning student-led enterprises on your candidate blurb. So my question to you is, given the budget constraints of OUSA, particularly with your emphasis this year on clubs, faculty groups and social causes, how financially viable is your proposal to invest in student-led enterprises?
The key thing to note is the difference between capital and operational expenditure. So this is something that we would look at using from the operational expenditure. So OUSA has large million-dollar investments in ways to generate revenue, but alongside that, we should also be investing in students and the entrepreneurial activities that they want to undertake. We already see a lot of things on campus, like Ignite and startups. And so I think it's well within the $1 million that we have in investments to set a little bit of that aside. We're probably talking about, you know, a very small proportion, 1/20th, to give student entrepreneurs a kickstart.
My question to Payal is relating to your emphasis on improving rental housing in your blog. So my question to you is, how do you plan on improving the quality of rental housing for students, given New Zealand's legislation favours the landlord over the tenant, and please provide concrete examples?
So there's recently been a legislation change, so all houses have to be insulated now. The way I'm jumping on board this is by running my flat template letter. It uses a concerned consumer approach, and pretty much there'll just be a template that all students will get. This will be well after exams in the summer, when people have already signed up for flats. What they do is they get this letter, and they customise it to work for them, and it clearly outlines the law change, what the landlord is required to do, and then you can use it to negotiate a time period when all of your flat is away from the flat that the landlord can access the flat to put in this insulation. I really don't want landlords applying for exemptions.
So my question to Nina is relating the emphasis of the student bar in your blog. So as the current finance officer who understands OUSA's budget process and limitations, how do you realistically propose we introduce a student bar?
As Paul has mentioned, we do have a significant investment portfolio. I believe that in the VSM environment, it's important that we diversify our income sources so that we aren't as reliant on the university to actually give us all of our money, because that means that we can't advocate against certain things that the university is doing that we don't like. So I would say that the best way to do this would be to take some money out of the investment portfolio, to draw out one of our term deposits perhaps, and use that to set up a student bar, and that would provide income for us, which over the course, I've done the figures, over the course of about 3 years would pay back, is my projected, how long it would take to actually pay for itself, and then it would just be providing a small amount of profit for OUSA.
Point of information, given that a refuel currently exists as a student bar and actually generates a loss, what is your justification for your belief that this will generate income for students?
I don't believe refuel is in the right place. People, when they go to town, they are going into town to places like Boogie and obviously used to go to the Monkey, to Cook, Fever, places like that. And I think that if OUSA wants a student bar to really succeed, then they need to be looking at buying something or leasing something, like either on the Octagon or very close to it, so that they actually get those people. Because if you sit outside refuel on a Saturday night, you can watch just hordes of people walking past on their way into town. It's just not in the right location.
So the next set of questions is specific to candidates once again, and is relating to common criticisms addressed to them. So to Paul, my question is, how do you respond to the criticism of yourself as an apolitical president in light of the closure of the design school and issues regarding NZUSA?
What students' associations need to do is to be able to work and lobby on all sides. It is true that I'm not an activist president. I'm a president who prefers to take arguments to the table and work through them and try and get some kind of resolution for one side. There are other candidates who might be really pro-protest and stuff. I think there's room for both of those. But I don't think we are apolitical at all. Being political means taking stands on issues. We've taken stands on many issues throughout the year. I don't think OUSA should be aligned to particular parties, and so we're apolitical in that sense, because I think we need to have an ability to criticise all parties and all politicians in order to be able to get wins for students.
Payal, my question to you is, how do you respond to the criticism that you are not a team player in the context of the executive?
I would say that I am definitely a team player, because it doesn't matter what initiative an executive member brings to the table, I will support them wholeheartedly to try and achieve it. It doesn't matter how silly I think it is, or if I think that's not what we should be doing. If they're passionate about something and they want to run it, I will find a way to make it happen. It's really up to individual exec members to drive their own projects, though.
My question to Nina is, how do you respond to the criticism that you have done little in your role as finance officer this year to reduce OUSA's dependency on service level agreement funding for the university?
I would say that the finance officer job is not a very public one in the way that some of the other ones are. So one of the things that we've been working on a lot this year is our investment portfolio, looking at the best way to reinvest that money so that we're earning the highest amount of interest possible to reduce our dependence on the university. Another thing that I'm doing currently, when I'm writing the budget for next year, is looking at unnecessary expenditure. There are a lot of things in this year's budget that are outdated and unnecessary, and so I've been looking at those sorts of things and finding ways that we don't actually need to spend that money by cutting costs, cutting down on our dependence on the university.
My question to Laura is, how do you respond to the criticism that you have not delivered on your election promises as Education Officer in 2014, namely positive change regarding student allowance?
I came through on my other two policies, so for a start, I don't think it would be fair to say I didn't come through on any. My other policies were the class representation system, which I did work towards improving, and there was a new system put in place under my reign. I also created a relationship between OUSA and summer school, which fostered events for students during lunchtimes. And I did a lot in my position as education officer. However, it is a 20-hour position, and I was under a president, and the president is the one who drives the ideals and the vision of OUSA. There's only so much you can do within those constraints. So just because I haven't had a chance to do it yet doesn't mean that I won't be able to, if I'm the president, who can lead these ideals and who can push these positive changes forward.
So the next question is a general question, and all candidates starting first with Payal. Seeing as how you have all been on the exec at one point or another, what has been your biggest weakness as an executive officer? And please provide an example.
I think my biggest weakness is definitely thinking that I had to be someone that I wasn't, try to be professional, try to do things in the ways that everyone else does it. I work so much more effectively now that I just go out there and do things the way that I think they should be done. Before, I was busy trying to look professional and speak professional and do all that. But really, I'm achieving a lot more just doing things my own way.
I think my biggest weakness as an executive officer this year has been certainly when I began the job was an inability or a weakness to not be able to distinguish between personal and professional capabilities. So I did end up doing things like taking things personally when I shouldn't have been, stuff like that, which did interfere with my productivity at the beginning of the year. That said, a number of things happened during the course of the year which mean that I'm kind of a lot more aware now of having to have those different hats and know that even if someone who, say, is a friend of mine on the executive says that one of my ideas isn't good, then that's not them insulting me as a person, that's them saying that they think my idea's not good, it's very different. So that's a weakness which I feel that I've overcome this year.
I would say my biggest weakness would have been not being able to keep to my hours, mainly because when it came to the summer school events that I had organised the relationship with last year, I spent an entire month at the beginning of this year running those events and working for those events during the week when it wasn't my job to do so, but it was in lieu of a new education officer. So probably not being able to step back from that role and take the year off.
I think the biggest weakness of my presidency is sort of not being front and centre or out there. I think there's been sort of a criticism, which is probably valid, that I'm not out there enough. Even on social media, I don't have like Twitter and Yik Yak and those kind of things. If I got re-elected, I'd look to be a bit more out there and communicating more frequently with students. That's my biggest weakness.
So my next question is a general question, beginning first with Nina. So what specific skills are you bringing to the role of the president that are unique to you, and how will they assist in your presidency?
I've got good policies. I'd like to think I'm fairly intelligent. And I'm accessible, which I think I'm accessible on a level that perhaps some of our other candidates aren't, and that I'm not looking to go into a career in politics. It's not that I'm doing this trying to get on the list for my particular favourite political party. I'm just a regular person who I've got good ideas and things that I want to do that will make life better for all students. And this is the way to go about doing it. And yeah.
I don't have any political aspirations either. I want to be a teacher, so far from it. Some things that I can bring to the experience are executive experience. I've been there before, I know the inner workings, it's not going to take me a really long time to figure out where I am, how to orientate myself. I've got that experience there. Also, I voluntarily managed the Are You OK program for a few years, so I know what it's like to be contacting with students, to be with students, to be involved with students and looking after students, and I know what they want and what they need. And the third thing is I've got a fantastic team behind me, three of whom are running uncontested and therefore will be on the executive. And they're working really hard. You can see that they're out there, they have their names out there, and they'll put in a really good effort next year. So I would definitely say that that is something that I have special to me that the other candidates are without.
I think the biggest strength specific to me is having been president this year. The role of president is quite different to every other position, and that in every other position you are able to pick what you do and do things that you like, but in prison you have to deal with a whole range of situations. And I think that experience is particularly valuable in terms of the relationships that were built up with different stakeholders and in terms of managing the executive. I've had experience with the pros and cons and will be better for it next year if elected.
I think the specific skills I bring is that I'm not just all talk, I'm actually doing it right now and I'll continue to do it. I don't have to make all these promises that I'm going to start doing next year. I'm working on it right now. I try really hard and I learn to do things even if I can't do them, even if it's way out of my comfort zone. I learn how to do it and I do it pretty well as well. I guess the biggest strength of myself is I don't let myself get in the way of doing something that's good. I don't have very high self-worth. That works really well for someone who you want to lead you. That doesn't work so well personally, but it's a great trait to have for a leader.
So the next question, once again, is a general question, starting first with Laura. What is your proudest achievement to date as an executive officer, and provide justification on why?
Absolutely, my proudest moment would have been the relationship that we made with summer school, which I've already discussed. And that's because that's an ongoing relationship that we have with the department and the university that will provide for students during summer school. That's both financially, that means that's not all coming out of our pocket to make sure that you guys have things to do during the breaks of summer school. It caters for those students who are around to the beginning of the year who might be by themselves because they're the first ones in Dunedin. So it looks after that advocacy issue, it looks after that student engagement issue, and there's I really am exceptionally proud of that, and I'm glad that it looks like it's going to go on for many years to come.
I think my proudest achievement is the new expenditure on social course groups and groups which are involved in the community. The way in which our students interact with the political sphere is changing. We're noticing a lot of people are attracted to specific causes, whether that be child poverty, environmentalism, or human rights internationally. And I think it's also important that we spend money on clubs which are also out there in the wider Dunedin community to foster the relationship between the university, which is a place where people come and go, and a community who are permanently here. Students today are interested in solving issues, and I think it's really important that OUSA backs them to solve those issues.
I think my proudest achievement that I've actually done is getting the kitten rooms and the puppy rooms up and running effectively way better than they used to. It was Ruby's idea, kudos to her. Last year I worked with it at the end of, I worked on it at the end of the year with Laura as well, but I think this year it's definitely become a well-run machine thanks to the lovely Alice Sowery for building a great form to have a great way to run it, and now we can run it way more regularly than ever before. We run it weekly. We ran it weekly in semester one. It's run about four times this semester as well, and we'll continue to run really successfully in the future. So I'm really proud of that.
My proudest achievement today will most definitely be the bottle buyback. I'm very proud of instigating that this year. So we've had two so far, and they've been very successful. Each one's brought in over 11,000 bottles. And I think very close to 11,000 bottles for the second one, and I've got a third one coming up on October 9th, save the date. But I've been really proud of that, encouraging students to think about their glassways, because it is a big problem in North Dunedin with broken glass on the streets, and this is one way which OUSA has come up with, and which I've come up with to try and negate that to some extent, and I'm proud of that.
Next question is a general question, first beginning with Paul. So how do you view the role of the President?
Well, it does a number of things, but two things in particular. The first one is to represent students, represent what they want at the various committees, whether that be University Council, whether that be with meeting with MPs, whether that be we talking in the media. The second important role of the President is obviously to manage and lead its executive, and also OUSA is a big organisation, and the President has an important role in overseeing and managing the relationship with, in particular, the Chief Executive of OUSA, as well as the Vice Chancellor of the University. Managing those relationships are particularly important to ensure that OUSA is able to make effective change.
Cool. So how I view the role of the OUSA president is you are the spokesperson for the students. You should help define what OUSA is focusing on and you should be able to unite your exec and harness what they're passionate about and what they care about and work together to make positive difference. Use all their individual talents and passions. This is why I think it's important not to be on a ticket, because then that's not really democracy. I think it's really important to work with all the different kinds of people. I think the most important thing is, you need to make sure that you are representing students. Oh yeah, you're on uni council too. So really, you're the spokesperson, you're the face of OUSA, and you need to make sure that you're representing all students in a way that they believe is them.
I would say that OUSA president has a number of roles. The first is as the face of OUSA, as the media spokesperson, and the person who, like, the outside world kind of sees as OUSA. The second role is to guide and steer their executive along lines which they think are the most beneficial for OUSA, and just to generally make sure that everything keeps running as smoothly as possible with the help of the CEO and the Vice President.
So again, I do believe the position's twofold. You've got, on one side of the coin, representation of students, being that voice and being able to pioneer the ideas of students and the issues with students on a national and local level. The second side of that is acknowledging that the exec are ideas people. They bring your ideas to you, and you should be able to pioneer and push those ideas out into the students and make sure that they get seen and follow through on. However, I do also think that it's about creating unity between your executive, and that's why it's good if you do run on a ticket.
Reporting mental health wellness has increased significantly, so there's two things that you can do to fix that. Firstly, is to advocate for the student allowance to be tied to the rate of inflation. Many government payments are tied to the rate of inflation, but the living allowance is not. So it should be. The second thing we can do on campus is use the student groups which exist at the moment, who run many welfare and academic support programs, and continue to invest in those to ensure there are visible mechanisms of help and ways that people can work with each other in order to have a good time at university.
So I think the biggest issues facing students are the conditions that we live in, so the conditions of flats, and the way that student loans and student allowances currently work. Realistic actions that I've done so far. Last year I ran... This year what I've done is submitted on the City Council's long-term plan to make sure students are being represented and thought about at a planning stage. And what I continue to do is make sure we get a tertiary model of representation that represents all students, so we can get traction together to work together to improve things for students. And with the conditions of flats here, I'll be running my neighbourhood project.
So the next question are specific questions relating to each of the candidates and the policies that outlined their blurb. So starting with Laura Harris. You've stated in your candidate blurb that you would like to increase the quality of services provided to students. And so my question to you is, what are some issues which you can identify with the current quality of services which are provided to students, and how do you plan on fixing them? And I do ask that you provide concrete examples.
It's a very good question. Services to students. The thing with OUSA is that I believe it serves for two different purposes. Half of that purpose is representation of students on a national level, the other half of that is services. And so the kind of services OUSA runs are things like the O-Week events, and I believe actually a lot of the people here have already spoken about mental health issues and increasing on the sort of welfare issues and unifying those clubs that deal with those issues and making sure that those are a priority and that the mental health issue is definitely dealt with. So I think that's a service that we can improve, the student support service. Not that it doesn't already do exceptionally well, but there are always improvements that can be made. Other services that we'd like to see provided for students are things like free flu shots, so that you have an opportunity to avoid the threat of flu, things like free graduation photos. These are all services that could be provided by OUSA that currently aren't being.
So Paul, your question is relating to you mentioning student-led enterprises on your candidate blog. So my question to you is, given the budget constraints of OUSA, particularly with your emphasis this year on clubs, faculty groups, and social causes, how financially viable is your proposal to invest in student-led enterprises?
The key thing to note is the difference between capital and operational expenditure. So this is something that we would look at using from the operational expenditure. So OUSA has large million-dollar investments in ways to generate revenue, but alongside that, we should also be investing in students and the entrepreneurial activities that they want to undertake. We already see a lot of things on campus, like Ignite and startups, and so I think it's well within the $1 million that we have in investments to set a little bit of that aside. We're probably talking about, you know, a very small proportion, 1/20th, to give student entrepreneurs a kickstart.
My question to Payal is relating to your emphasis on improving rental housing in your blog. So my question to you is, how do you plan on improving the quality of rental housing for students, given New Zealand's legislation favours the landlord over the tenant? And please provide concrete examples.
So there's recently been a legislation change. So all houses have to be insulated now. The way I'm jumping on board this is by running my flat template letter. It uses a concerned consumer approach, and pretty much there'll just be a template that all students will get. This will be well after exams in the summer, when people have already signed up for flats. What they do is they get this letter and they customize it to work for them, and it clearly outlines the law change, what the landlord is required to do, and then you can use it to negotiate a time period when all of your flat is away from the flat, that the landlord can access the flat to put in this insulation. I really don't want landlords applying for exemptions.
So my question to Nina is relating the emphasis of the student bar in your blog. So as the current finance officer who understands OUSA's budget process and limitations, how do you realistically propose we introduce a student bar?
As Paul has mentioned, we do have a significant investment portfolio. I believe that in the VSM environment, it's important that we diversify our income sources so that we aren't as reliant on the university to actually give us all of our money, because that means that we can't advocate against certain things that the university is doing that we don't like. So I would say that the best way to do this would be to take some money out of the investment portfolio, to draw out one of our term deposits perhaps, and use that to set up a student bar, and that would provide income for us, which over the course, I've done the figures, over the course of about 3 years would pay back, as my projected, how long it would take to actually pay for itself, and then it would just be providing a small amount of profit for OUSA.
Point of information, given that Refuel currently exists as a student, or your belief that this will generate income for students?
I don't believe Refuel is in the right place. People, when they go to town, they're going into town to places like Boogie and obviously used to go to the Monkey, to Cook, Fever, places like that. And I think that if OUSA wants a student bar to really succeed, then they need to be looking at buying something or leasing something, like either on the Octagon or very close to it, so that they actually get those people. Because if you sit outside Refuel on a Saturday night, you can watch just hordes of people walking past on their way into town. It's just not in the right location.
So the next set of questions is specific to candidates once again, and is relating to common criticisms addressed to them. So to Paul, my question is, how do you respond to the criticism of yourself as an apolitical president in light of the closure of the design school and issues regarding NZUSA?
Well, students' associations need to do is to be able to work and lobby on all sides. It is true that I'm not an activist president. I'm a president who prefers to take arguments to the table and work through them and try and get some kind of resolution for one side. There are other candidates who might be really pro-protest and stuff. I think there's room for both of those. But I don't think we are apolitical at all. Being political means taking stands on issues. We've taken stands on many issues throughout the year. I don't think OUSA should be aligned to particular parties, so we're apolitical in that sense, because I think we need to have an ability to criticise all parties and all politicians in order to be able to get wins for students.
Now, my question to you is, How do you respond to the criticism that you are not a team player in the context of the executive?
I would say that I am definitely a team player because it doesn't matter what initiative an executive member brings to the table, I will support them wholeheartedly to try and achieve it. It doesn't matter how silly I think it is or if I think that's not what we should be doing. If they're passionate about something and they want to run it, I will find a way to make it happen. It's really up to individual exec members to drive their own projects though.
My question to Nina is, how do you respond to the criticism that you have done little in your role as finance officer this year to reduce OUSA's dependency on service level agreement funding from university?
I would say that the finance officer job is not a very public one in the way that some of the other ones are. So one of the things that we've been working on a lot this year is our investment portfolio, looking at the best way to reinvest that money so that we're earning the highest amount of interest possible to reduce our dependence on the university. Another thing that I'm doing currently, when I'm writing the budget for next year, is looking at unnecessary expenditure. There are a lot of things in this year's budget that are outdated and unnecessary, and so I've been looking at those sorts of things and finding ways that we don't actually need to spend that money by cutting costs, you know, cutting down on our dependence on the university.
My question to Laura is, how do you respond to the criticism that you have not delivered on your election promises as Education Officer in 2014, namely positive change regarding student allowance?
I came through on my other two policies, so for a start, I don't think it would be fair to say I didn't come through on any. My other policies were the class representation system, which I did work towards improving, and there was a new system put in place under my reign. I also created a relationship between OUSA and summer school, which fostered events for students during lunchtimes. And I did a lot in my position as education officer. However, it is a 20-hour position, and I was under a president, and the president is the one who drives the ideals and the vision of OUSA. There's only so much you can do within those constraints. So just because I haven't had a chance to do it yet doesn't mean that I won't be able to, if I'm the president, who can lead these ideals and who can push these positive changes forward.
So the next question is a general question aimed at all candidates, starting first with Payal. Seeing as how you have all been on the exec at one point or another, what has been your biggest weakness as an executive officer? And please provide an example.
I think my biggest weakness is definitely thinking that I had to be someone that I wasn't, try to be professional, try to do things in the ways that everyone else does it. I work so much more effectively now that I just go out there and do things the way that I think they should be done. Before, I was busy trying to look professional and speak professional and do all that. But really, I'm achieving a lot more just doing things my own way.
I think my biggest weakness as an executive officer this year has been when I began the job was an inability or a weakness to not be able to distinguish between personal and professional capabilities. So I did end up doing things like taking things personally when I shouldn't have been, stuff like that, which did interfere with my productivity at the beginning of the year. That said, a number of things happened during the course of the year which mean that I'm kind of a lot more aware now of having to have those different hats and know that even if someone who, say, is a friend of mine on the executive says that I don't, that one of my ideas isn't good, then that's not them insulting me as a person, that's them saying that they think my idea's not good, it's very different. So that's a weakness which I feel that I've overcome this year.
I would say my biggest weakness would have been not being able to keep to my hours, mainly because when it came to the summer school events that I had organised the relationship with last year, I spent an entire month at the beginning of this year running those events and working for those events during the week when it wasn't my job to do so. But it was in lieu of a new education officer. So probably not being able to step back from that role and take the year off.
I think the biggest weakness of my presidency is sort of not being front and centre or out there. I think there's been sort of a criticism which is probably valid that I'm not out there enough. Even on social media, I don't have like Twitter and Yik Yak and those kind of things. If I got re-elected, I'd look to be a bit more out there and communicating more frequently with students. That's my biggest weakness.
So my next question is a general question, beginning first with Nina. So what specific skills are you bringing to the role of the president that are unique to you, and how will they assist in your presidency?
I've got good policies. I'd like to think I'm fairly intelligent, and I'm accessible, which I think I'm accessible on a level that perhaps some of our other candidates aren't, and that I'm not looking to go into a career in politics. It's not that I'm doing this trying to get on the list for my particular favourite political party. I'm just a regular person who I've got good ideas and things that I want to do that will make life better for all students, and this is the way to go about doing it. And yeah.
I don't have any political aspirations either. I want to be a teacher, so far from it. Some things that I can bring to the experience are executive experience. I've been there before, I know the inner workings, it's not going to take me a really long time to figure out where I am, how to orientate myself. I've got that experience there. Also, I voluntarily managed the OUSA program for a few years, so I know what it's like to be contacting with students, to be with students, to be involved with students and looking after students, and I know what they want and what they need. And the third thing is I've got a fantastic team behind me, three of whom are running uncontested and therefore will be on the executive. And they're working really hard. You can see that they're out there, they have their names out there, and they'll put in a really good effort next year. So I would definitely say that that is something that I have special to me that the other candidates are without.
I think the biggest strength specific to me is having been president. This year, the role of president is quite different to every other position, and that in every other position, you are able to pick what you do and do things that you like. But in president, you have to deal with a whole range of situations. And I think that experience is particularly valuable in terms of the relationships that were built up with different stakeholders, and in terms of managing the executive. I've had experience with the pros and cons, and will be better for it next year if elected.
I think the specific skills I bring is that I'm not just all talk, I'm actually doing it right now and I'll continue to do it. I don't have to make all these promises that I'm going to start doing next year. I'm working on it right now. I try really hard and I learn to do things even if I can't do them, even if it's way out of my comfort zone. I learn how to do it and I do it pretty well as well. And I guess the biggest strength of myself is I don't let myself get in the way of doing something that's good. I don't have very high self-worth. That works really well for someone who you want to lead you. That doesn't work so well personally, but it's a great trait to have for a leader.
So the next question, once again, is a general question, starting first with Laura. What is your proudest achievement to date as an executive officer, and provide justification on why?
Absolutely, my proudest moment would have been the relationship that we made with summer school, which I've already discussed. And that's because that's an ongoing relationship that we have with the department and the university that will provide for students during summer school. That's both financially, that means that's not all coming out of our pocket to make sure that you guys have things to do during the breaks of summer school. It caters for those students who are around to the beginning of the year who might be by themselves because they're the first ones in Dunedin. So it looks after that advocacy issue, it looks after that student engagement issue, and there's I really am exceptionally proud of that, and I'm glad that it looks like it's going to go on for many years to come.
I think my proudest achievement is the new expenditure on social course groups and groups which are involved in the community. The way in which our students interact with the political sphere is changing. We're noticing a lot of people are attracted to specific causes, whether that be child poverty, environmentalism, or human rights internationally. And I think it's also important that we spend money on clubs which are also out there in the wider Dunedin community to foster the relationship between the university, which is a place where people come and go, and a community who are permanently here. Students today are interested in solving issues, and I think it's really important that OUSA backs them to solve those issues.
I think my proudest achievement that I've actually done is getting the kin rooms and the puppy rooms up and running effectively way better than they used to. It was Ruby's idea, kudos to her. Last year I worked on it at the end of the year with Laura as well, but I think this year it's definitely become a well-run machine thanks to the lovely Alice Dowry for building a great form to have a great way to run it, and now we can run it way more regularly than ever before. We run it weekly. We ran it weekly in semester one. It's run about four times this semester as well, and we'll continue to run really successfully in the future. So I'm really proud of that.
My proudest achievement today will most definitely be the bottle buyback. I'm very proud of instigating that this year. So we've had two so far, and they've been very successful. Each one's brought in over 11,000 bottles, and I think very close to 11,000 bottles for the second one. And I've got a third one coming up on October 9th, save the date. But I've been really proud of that, encouraging students to think about their glass waste, because it is a big problem in North Dunedin with broken glass on the streets, and this is one way which OUSA has come up with, and which I've come up with to try and negate that to some extent, and I'm proud of that.
So my next question is a general question, first beginning with Paul. So how do you view the role of the president?
Well, it does a number of things, but two things in particular. The first one is to represent students, represent what they want at the various committees, whether that be university council, whether that be with meeting with MPs, whether that be we talking in the media. The second important role of the president is obviously to manage and lead its executive, and also OUSA is a big organisation, and the president has an important role in overseeing and managing the relationship with, in particular, the chief executive of OUSA, as well as the vice chancellor of the university. Managing those relationships are particularly important to ensure that OUSA is able to make effective change.
Cool. So how I view the role of the OUSA president is you are the spokesperson for the students. You should help define what OUSA is focusing on and you should be able to unite your exec and harness what they're passionate about and what they care about and work together to make positive difference. Use all their individual talents and passions. This is why I think it's important not to be on a ticket, because then that's not really democracy. I think it's really important to work with all the different kinds of people. I think the most important thing is, you need to make sure that you are representing students. Oh yeah, you're on uni council too. So really, you're the spokesperson, you're the face of OUSA, and you need to make sure that you're representing all students in a way that they believe is them.
I would say that OUSA president has a number of roles. The first is as the face of OUSA, as the media spokesperson, and the person who the outside world kind of sees as OUSA. The second role is to guide and steer their executive along lines which they think are the most beneficial for OUSA, and just to generally make sure that everything keeps running as smoothly as possible with the help of the CEO and the Vice President.
So again, I do believe the position's twofold. You've got on one side of the coin representation of students, being that voice and being able to pioneer the ideas of students and the issues with students on a national and local level. The second side of that is acknowledging that the exec are ideas people. They bring their ideas to you, and you should be able to pioneer and push those ideas out into the students and make sure that they get seen and follow through it on. However, I do also think that it's about creating unity between your executive, and that's why it's good if you do run on a ticket.